Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones he was dying to save, are the sum of his life and works, his gift to us, his heart, and the sound bites of God.
Well, good morning. How are you? We are in a series, Sound Bites. Jesus said seven statements on the cross. So while we're in the season of Lent, we've been looking at those seven statements. They're short statements is why we're calling them sound bites. But they're important. They're significant because they're his last words as he's dying on the cross. I have this book that I wanted to share with you. It's called Last Words of Notable People. And it's an interesting book where they have a list of people that some more notable than others, that as they're dying, their last words. Now, it's supposed to be kind of a serious book, but it has some somewhat humorous ones in there as well. I wanted to share a couple of those with you. There's a guy named James Rogers. He was a criminal, and he was sentenced to dying by firing squad. So they said, do you have any last words before they were going to execute him by firing squad? He said, can I have a bulletproof vest? He said, no. So, another one, a guy named a general, John Sedgwick, a Union commander during the Civil War. He was shot by the, he was shot as he's looking, and he's saying those Confederates couldn't hit an elephant from this dis. And then he was shot. So then there's Pancho Villa. Everybody's heard of him. The Mexican leader, he was known as saying as he was shot and he was laying in this car, and his last words were, don't let it end like this. Tell people I said something. Now, Jesus has these last words, and they're significant. I've been in ministry over 35 years, I've talked to people as they've said their last words on their deathbed. They're significant. As they're thinking through their whole life and they're summarizing it, it's a big deal. And so Jesus says these things that are a big deal. So we're going to look at those. We're actually concluding with the last of the last statements that he said. So if you have your Bibles, open those up, please. Open them up. We're going to be looking at a few verses. One in Luke 23, and then we'll flip over and look at something out of John. Luke 23, verses 44 through 47. Here's what it says. It says, by this time it was noon, but darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. So from noon all the way to 3 o'clock, Jesus had been crucified at 9 in the morning. And so at noon, when it's normally bright, it's darkness. There's a darkness that's covered over the land. Maybe a storm, maybe clouds, who knows. But not only is it dark, but there's kind of a darkness about it. You know, like kind of like evil is winning. And that's certainly how it looked for people that were standing by that didn't understand the great plan that was unfolding. They looked at it, and here's Jesus. He was the Messiah, lived this perfect life, and done miracles and all these great things, and now they're crucifying him. And a criminal's death, and they're going, this is wrong. This is wrong. Even the disciples didn't even get it all. They were just going, this doesn't look right. So there's this darkness that falls over the land, over them. The light from the sun was gone, and suddenly the thick veil hanging in the temple was torn apart. Now, there's some symbolism there. That when that was torn, it also tore the separation that was between humankind and God, but we're not going to be able to get into that today. So there's this thick veil that was torn. Then Jesus shouted. Now, here's his final words. He's shouting these, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. I trust my spirit into your hands. And with those words, he breathes his last. When the captain of the Roman soldiers, this is this captain who would have been over like 100 soldiers there, and he's He's in charge of the executions. He says, handle me the execution, saw what happened. He praised God. Now, this guy is not a follower of Jesus. He's not a believer, but yet he praises God and said, surely this man was innocent. Matthew adds, surely this man was innocent and the Son of God. And so here's this hardened Roman soldier. One of their tasks was overseeing crucifixions and executions. In that day, they did a lot of crucifixions. They crucified criminals. They crucified political opponents. In fact, there was sometimes hundreds of crucifixions a day. He was in charge of these. He was familiar with this. He had seen many, many, probably hundreds, if not thousands, of executions through crucifixion. And yet he looks at Jesus when Jesus is crucified. He goes, he's not like all the others. This guy here, he's innocent. He's the Son of God. Why would he say that? Well, certainly because of the way Jesus died. I mean, you see these statements. Nobody else forgave their executioners as Jesus did when he said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Nobody else would refuse to take painkillers when they're in agony, one of the most torturous types of deaths that you could experience. And in the midst of that, they offer him a painkiller, and he goes, no, there's a purpose to this pain. There's a reason going on here. And he looked at that, and he goes, that's odd. That's not normal. And then the thief on the cross, the criminal, the murderer who is blasting Jesus and then finally kind of repents at the end. And Jesus turns to him and he says, today you'll be with me in paradise. And certainly nobody who he had crucified said, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. So he sees these things and he goes, this is not how people normally die. And that's true. People don't normally die like that. Jesus was not like everybody else. And so he goes, he's innocent. He's the Son of God. And now in this, I think it's interesting that we can see really a pattern for how to die. I don't know if you've ever thought about that, but most people have a chance to kind of think about their death before they die. Some people just die, you know, instantaneously in a car accident or something, but most people, that's not their situation. Most people, you have months or weeks, days, maybe even hours before you die, and you have a chance to think about it and prepare for it. Have you ever thought of there's a way to die well? Jesus gives us a model on how to die well. One of the things that we see is that he's at peace. He knows this is his time. He's not fighting it. He's not resisting it. He's at peace with that. Another thing that we see from Jesus is he's not angry. He's not bitter. He doesn't have unresolved conflict. Unreconciled relationships. Just a lot of people, they have just accumulated that over their lifetime. All these unreconciled relationships. And sometimes they just go, it'll just never be different. It'll never change. Bible says that be at peace with all men as far as it is concerned, as far as it is concerned about you. And so Jesus had none of those, no unreconciled relationships. Jesus was secure in where he was going. He knew he was going to heaven. He was secure in that. And Jesus also had trust. Here he is in those final moments. I entrust my spirit to you. To the Father. There's this level of trust that's going on. And these are the things that go into dying well and making sure that you're prepared, because obviously that's going to come at some point for all of us. Now, all four Gospels say that Jesus shouted. Only two tell us what he said. Now, the first one we just looked at, he shouted this, Father, into your hands, or actually a different phrase, different versions say it differently, but, you know, I entrust my spirit into your hands, or into your hands I commit my spirit. This is one of the things that Jesus shouts, not in anger, not in despair, but he says it in a declarative way, saying, I'm going to entrust you, God, in this moment. Here's another thing that he says. Second thing, Jesus knew, this is in John 19, John 19, beginning in verse 28. Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. He said, it is finished. That's the other soundbite. It is finished. Then he bowed his head and released his spirit. So you have these two statements. One is a statement of victory. One is a statement of trust. It is finished. That's actually one word, just finished. But to make a full sentence in English, it is finished. The word is, it's a Greek word, tetelestai, and it was a word used in commerce when primarily in banking, if you had a line of credit, they would start adding up the debts that you owed. And as you went back and got more credit, you would owe more, and they kept adding that up. If you went and you paid that off, they would stamp on your bill of sale, your receipt, they would stamp on it, tetelestai, which means paid in full. It's finished, it's over, it's done. You owe nothing else. And this is what Jesus declares. He says, paid in full. He's talking about the moral indebtedness that we owe a holy God, that over a lifetime we accumulate indebtedness, just like a lender gives out money. And so God, over a lifetime, we kind of accumulate this indebtedness, all the things we do wrong, whether it's intentional or unintentional, when we hurt people, when we those small lies, the big ones, then we just accumulate over a lifetime all of this indebtedness that keeps this separation from us and God, who is holy and perfect. And so Jesus' mission was to cancel that debt. The only way that could be canceled by Jesus living a pure, holy life and then taking on penalties that he didn't deserve. All of the things that people did wrong, he took upon him on that cross. And when that was done, he declared, paid in full. Your sins are paid in full. And so that's what he's saying. He's declaring this. That's why he's shouting it out. Now, people, when they're dying, they don't... I've visited, like I said, a number of people over the years, and I visited somebody just 2 weeks ago. She couldn't talk at all. And then she died that night after I prayed with her. People don't yell when they're dying. They whisper because they don't have any energy. Jesus has been on the cross for 6 hours. He's been tortured. He's suffocating to death. He's bleeding to death. And he had been tortured for hours and hours before that, excruciating pain. And in that case, people usually just can maybe squeeze out a little groan. Jesus declares, he yells out, it is finished, paid in full. And then he doesn't just end with that. He goes on and he says, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. Two great things that he says. Now, when we look at those, we realize that God had a mission he was doing. He had a mission, and because he had a mission, we know three things. Number one, that he gave his life voluntarily. Nobody took that from him. Sometimes I've been watching some of these shows that have been on TV lately as it's ramping up for Easter. And one of the shows they were talking about, who actually killed Jesus? Why? What's the real reason he died? Was it Pilate? Was it the Roman soldiers? Was it the temple guards, the Jewish temple guards? Was it the crowd? Why did Jesus actually die? And the truth is, it was his own choice. He chose to go to the cross. If he didn't want to go to the cross, he wouldn't have had to. He was the Son of God. He could have done anything he wanted. He could have stopped it. He was not a victim. It was not a tragedy. It was not like, oh my goodness, can you believe this? No, that's part of his mission. Jesus said at one point, he said, no one can take my life from me. I lay down my life voluntarily, for I have the authority to lay it down when I want to, and also the power to take it back again. Jesus was not a victim. He chose to do this. So he did it voluntarily. He also did it confidently, as I pointed out. He shouted these words. He shouted it because he was confident about it. He wasn't timid. He knew what he was doing. He had a mission. So he's declaring it, shouting it out. It is finished. And then third, he was trusting God. This phrase that he uses, Father, I commit my spirit, I entrust my spirit into your hands. That's actually from the Old Testament, from one of the Psalms, Psalm 31:5, which was a common psalm that were taught to children particularly. Kind of like some of the little prayers we teach our kids. They would be taught this prayer. Mary undoubtedly taught Jesus this prayer. This would have been a prayer he would have grown up with. And so his last words, he's saying this simple prayer, like a childlike prayer. Christians throughout history have prayed a prayer like this. You have Stephen, who's the first martyr. He's being stoned for his faith. And as he's dying, his dying words are similar. He just says, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. It's the same kind of thing. Now, as a side note, I wanted to say that I know there's this idea of last rites, but that's not in the Bible. Last rites is something that was added hundreds and hundreds of years later by people. The apostles never did any last rites. The disciples didn't. You don't need last rites to go to heaven. That is a man-made thing brought up hundreds of years later. The Bible doesn't teach anything about that. And so that's not what we're talking about here. But we are looking at Jesus in his darkest days, a statement that he said, these sound bites, and how when we're in our darkest days, we can draw energy, we can draw encouragement, life, faith from the same thing that Jesus did. Let's look at that. Four things. Number one, when we are in our darkest days, remember, I have a Father in heaven who loves me. Now, I noticed that Jesus' first word is Father. He says, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. Father, Jesus is the one who started this idea of calling God Father. This was not part, faiths and religions had never done that. God was big, he was grand, he was out there. But he was not personal, and Jesus calls him Father. Now, just a few statements earlier, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's the only time in the Bible that Jesus refers to God other than calling him my Father. And it's because at that moment, when he says, why have you forsaken me? It's in that moment that the sins of the world were being placed on Jesus. He was distant. There was this separation. He was taking on all of the sin of the world. And so he's declaring that, my God, why have you forsaken me? Expressing that. But now, at this point, as he's about to die, as he's about to, his last final words, as he's actually going to pass on, that's already been paid for. And he says, he talks about his Father. He says, Father. And Jesus taught his disciples. And they said, hey, how do we pray? And he said, well, here's how you pray. Say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Our Father, that was revolutionary. People never thought like that. The term he actually uses for Father is an Aramaic word, Abba. It's one of the first words a child would learn. It's easy to say. Abba. And he says, this is what I want you to think when you're thinking about God. Not some distant deity out there who doesn't care, but is not just a father, but like a papa, like a daddy, where you are utterly trusting. Children, if you've had kids, you know when they're real young, they really trust you. Then they grow up and they realize, oh, you're not that trustworthy. That's a wake-up call, right, sometimes. But Jesus says, you know, he's like that. Daddy. Father, this idea that not only is he a dad, but he's a dad who loves me. He loves me. Jesus said, I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I am leaving the world and I go back to the Father. And so Jesus is saying that this is what God is like. Now, sometimes people have a hard time with that because they say, well, my dad was not good. He was a bad dad. He was distant, he was far, he was, you know, maybe abusive, he was demeaning. So I have a hard time, but see, this is not what God is like. God is not like a dad who does all those things. He's our Father in heaven. He's consistent and caring. He's loving. He's capable. He cares about us. He's interested in you. He's consistent. All of those things describe our Father in heaven. The Bible says in Psalm 103, verse 13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord, that's God, has compassion on those who honor him. He says, no matter what you're going through, whether it's a financial problem or a problem with your job or some kind of crisis in your home or whatever, he says, God's interested in that stuff. God loves you. Here's something you might want to write down. God loves me more than I love me. And that's true. It's hard to believe because we can think, well, nobody loves me more than me. But actually, that's wrong. God loves you more than you love yourself. He cares about you. And that's the first thing we see that we can learn from this soundbite on the cross. Father, he loves me. But not only does he love me, he is trustworthy. Number two, my heavenly Father can be trusted. Sometimes physical fathers can't be trusted, right? Sometimes they're inconsistent. I talked to one guy, he said, I never knew my dad was an alcoholic. I never knew whether he'd hug me or slug me. Inconsistent fathers produce insecure children. And then they feel uncomfortable. It messes with their psyche. But God is consistent and he is trustworthy. He's trustworthy. And one of the most important things that you and I can do is determine who we're going to really trust. I mean, what are we going to trust with our life? Jesus said, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. So he made a decision. This is what he's going to do with who he's going to trust. Who are you going to trust with the things that are most important to you? You're going to trust somebody. So let me give you some options and then we'll vote. How many of you say, I'm going to trust with my life the decisions that come out of Congress? Congress. I'm going to believe Congress. No, that might not be the best plan. They're having a hard time figuring it out right now, right? How about I'm going to trust the media with my life? No, I mean, but you know, I mean, if that's the way we might live like that, we might laugh and say, oh, no, that's not true. But then our peace and our happiness and all of that goes up and down based on legislation and what the media says. It's not really rooted in God's word. It's rooted in the media and Congress. Because that's what we trust. How about this? How many of you would say, I'm going to trust my life to popular opinion? That's probably not too wise. How about, I'm going to trust my life to my emotions? Well, however I feel that day. That's how things are going to go. Well, that's probably not too good because we lie to ourselves all the time. We can't trust our emotions. I mean, we lie to ourselves. We tell ourselves it's worse than it really is. And then the next day we tell ourselves it's better than it really is. Now, really, it's good news to realize that you can't trust your emotions because that's one of the easiest and quickest ways that you can reclaim peace in your life. When you realize, yeah, I don't have to believe me. I'm probably lying. You know? So who says I have to believe me? I'm going to believe what God says about me. I'm going to believe what God says is true about the world. Not my latest flavor of the month emotion. So you can really catapult yourself into a way better place in your life by choosing who you're going to trust and put it into the right thing. Now, I recommend the person you choose to trust with your life has three characteristics. Number one, that they know everything. That's always good. They know everything. There's no blind spots. Number two is that they always have your best interest at heart. You're number one on their list. And number three is that they will tell you the truth even if it hurts. Yeah. Even if it hurts. These things are important. Now, of course, there's only one person who can do that, and that's God, right? God knows everything, has your best interest in mind, and will tell you the truth even if it doesn't feel so good. And when you base your decisions and your life on those, you're going to have a much better outcome, a much better outcome. So you trust. You say, I'm going to trust in the Lord. I'm going to trust because he's perfect. And no matter how dark it is, Psalm 33:4 says, for the word of the Lord holds true. And everything he does is worthy of our trust. You can't say that about anybody. Everything they do is worthy of my trust. I don't want you to say that about me. I mean, I'm your pastor. I love you, but I'm a fallible human. I'm going to drop the ball. I'm going to make mistakes. Nobody on this planet is worthy of that statement, but God is. Everything he does is worthy of our trust. So Jesus says, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. That word entrust is a Greek word. It's parathemi, and it means to make a deposit. It means to deposit something. And it was commonly used to refer to what we would think of like a safety deposit box. You know, where you go to a bank and you rent that box and it's extra secure there, right? They've got a vault and they have security systems, they have law enforcement, they have all of these extra reinforcing things, because what you put in there, you don't want stolen, you don't want lost, you don't want it devalued in any way. That is too precious to you. And he says that's the kind of trust that God's talking about. You put that level of security, saying, this is so important, I'm putting this in God's safety deposit box, his hands. I'm putting this. Now, what would you put in there? What goes in God's safety deposit box? Well, let me give you a hint. Whatever worries you. Whatever you're worried about. When something worries you, if you're worried about your kids, it can be a good thing. It doesn't mean a bad thing. It can be your kids. If you were to lose anything and it would devastate your life, your priorities need to change. You need to be able to put those things into God's hands. And so if you're worried about your kids, how they're going to turn out, you're worried about your health, you're worried about your investments and your finances, you're worried about your school, you're worried about your job, you're worried about your promotion. There's a lot of things to be worried about in this life. So whatever is worrying you, that's what you need to put in God's hands. That's what you need to put in his security box. Worry really is just practical atheism. It means that you're saying, I don't have a father who loves me and is trustworthy. I mean, we might say something different because we know maybe the right word, the right thing. It's like a check the box. God is loving. He will care for me. But then we live in a life of worry. It means that really it doesn't matter if we check that box. We don't believe that. We're operating like God does not love me and I can't trust him. And so worry. Say, I'm not going to worry anymore. I'm going to. When that comes up, it's like a little light on the dashboard of your car. It's blinking, saying, you have a trust issue. You need to realign your thoughts. You need to put your belief in what God says about you. Trust, trust, trust. Jesus says, I entrust my spirit into your hands. You know, sometimes the most difficult time to trust God is when we're in pain. Jesus is in enormous pain here. He's been crucified. He's in all racked in torturous pain. And yet in those moments, see, he goes, that's the time to trust, regardless of my pain. And he focuses on the Father, not on the pain. Now, Paul does something similar. He tells us in 2 Timothy, he says, I am suffering here in prison. He didn't deserve to be in prison. He's there because he was sharing the gospel. And they were upset at him, so they throw him in prison. But I am not ashamed of it, for I know the one in whom I trust. And I am sure there's that confidence that he is able to protect and keep. There's the safety deposit box. He can keep what? What I have entrusted to him until the day of his return. So I can trust God that he's going to watch over me, that he loves me, and that he's trustworthy. Number three, my Father is taking care of the things I can't see. Now, there's plenty of things we can't see. Now, we live in a material world, right? I mean, there's a physical world, but there's more to the life than just what we see. Life is more than just what we see and what our brains can comprehend. I mean, there's radio waves, right, and TV waves. They go right through us. We don't see them. But you put a signal up here and then a radio behind you or something, or a TV, and all of a sudden you go, wow, it's going right through me, and it is. Quantum physics, when scientists look at that, there's a lot of things they can't see, they don't even understand. In quantum physics, it breaks the actual physical laws. This is impossible. How can it happen? Because there's things that are not seen. And there's things like evil that is not seen. It's very real. I mean, the bombing that happened this morning in the two churches in Egypt, killing the Christians there, that's evil. Now, we see the symptoms of that evil, but the evil is invisible. There's evil lurking in the world. And there's hatred, and there's envy, there's jealousy, there's bitterness. There's all kinds of very, very real, but invisible, unseen realities. We can't see the future, and yet we can trust that God sees the future. You see, God can see things we can't see. He sees the spiritual. He sees the future. He sees the thing behind our pain. When we're in pain, when we're in a tough spot, generally that's all we can see. God sees a purpose behind it. He's at work behind the challenges that we're involved in. And so part of trusting God is saying, Father, he's loving. I trust you with my spirit. There's a spiritual element. You know, scientists are creating artificial intelligence at this breakneck speed. Already we have computers that we have created as human beings that are way smarter than us. But they're still different because we are not just an intellect. You're an intellect, but you're not just an intellect. You have more than that. You have a spirit. There's a spiritual part of you that is going to last forever. You see, everything in the world that we see is going to deteriorate. These chairs that you're sitting on, by the second law of thermodynamics, it will deteriorate over time. The trees outside, this building will deteriorate. Your body is deteriorating. Anybody want to give a testimony about that? Right? I mean, there's no going back. It's deteriorating. But your spirit will last forever. There's the unseen things are the things that last forever. And God says he's overseen all of that. This is what Jesus is talking about. There's something bigger that God's at work at. And when we're in our dark days, God's at work with solutions. And that's part of trusting. That's when we entrust and say, I trust God is over that. So Jesus said, I trust my spirit. So you can circle those words, my spirit. It implies there's more than just our bodies. There's more, and the Bible says there is. There's more. Now notice here in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 17 and 18 says, our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. That far outweighs them all. In other words, there's something bigger than your problems. Sometimes that's all we can see, but God sees the bigger picture. And he says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. He says, this is the things that really matter, the eternal things, and don't forget that. So in our dark days, we remember that God's loving, I can entrust things that are most important to me, certainly anything that worries me, to his care, and that there's something bigger than things I can't see. There's a plan that's operating behind the scenes that God is watching over. And then number four, my Father can handle anything I put into his hands. Anything I put into his hands. So, Father, he's loving. I entrust, he's trustworthy. My spirit, there's a spiritual element at work. And then I put those into his hands. You know that TV commercial, Allstate, where they have like the little hands and they say, you know, you're in good hands at Allstate, right? What are they implying? They're implying that if you have that insurance company, you're going to be taken care of. Right? Well, God's hands are bigger than Allstate's. I mean, God's hands, they've got the whole world in his hands. Somebody should write a song about that. That's a good idea. I mean, God is, his hands are big. And what it means is it's a beautiful picture of somebody who's caring, somebody who you can trust. You know, when my kids were little and I would, you know, if they were like, I was in the pool and they were going to jump in, I'd say, jump, you can trust me, right? And I'd have my hands out to kind of demonstrate that. That's kind of what's going on here, where God's saying, you can trust me. You can trust God. His hands will catch you. His hands will catch you, no matter what you're going through. Jesus' hands were pierced with nails. That was demonstrating how much God loves for you. He was going to every length possible to tell you, you matter to him. That it's not okay that you're separated, that you're far from him. And you know, Jesus, even in when he was resurrected, which we're going to celebrate next weekend at Easter. But when he was resurrected, he still had those nail prints on his hands, the scars on his feet. He showed his disciples. He showed other people. Now, when we get to heaven, we won't have any scars. We get new bodies. I'm pretty happy about that. I just collected a whole bunch of extra scars. I just had a surgery on my knee, torn ACL. Now I look like Edward Scissorhands did a little massage on me or something, you know, and it's crisscrossing every way. Heaven, I get a new one. I mean, no more scars, no pimples, no warts. It's all gone. But Jesus will still have his scars because he has them forever to remind us for all eternity the price that was paid for our salvation. It wasn't free. And it also reminds us constantly how much God loves us, how much he loves you. He will always have those nail prints. Isaiah, the prophet, says that. He says, I have engraved you into the palms of my hands. Engraving. It's kind of like a tattoo. People get tattoos of people they love. God loves you. He had you tattooed onto his hands. Then engraving those scars, the nail marks, always reminding you, you matter. Your problems matter. And he's at work. You might not see it. All you see is what's right in front of you, the crisis that's in front of you, but God's at work. And we remind ourselves of that every time we pray the prayer that Jesus prayed. Father, I entrust this problem, this worrisome thing, whatever it is, into your hands. Into your hands. Notice this last verse. Paul says, I think you ought to know, dear brothers, about the hard time we went through in Asia. We were really crushed and overwhelmed and feared we would never live through it. Now, maybe you feel that way about something. You're looking at it and you're going, I'm crushed, I'm overwhelmed, I'm not sure I'll live through this thing. And when you're in those dark days, it can look pretty dark. And it's in those moments, see, when we can draw from what Jesus did when he was in his dark time. He says, we felt we were doomed to die and saw how powerless we were to help ourselves. But, and notice he says, that was good. What was good? He goes, that was good. Why? Because for then we put everything into the hands of God, who alone could save us, for he can even raise the dead. You see, when we're in those places, when things are good, we walk around whistling Dixie and everything's happy. When things are difficult, it's time to evaluate. It's time to say, okay, is it true that everything is really in God's hands? Is it true? So if I'm filled with fear, that's the time to say, Father, I entrust this fear into your hands. If we're worried, Father, I entrust this worry into your hands. If you have anger, God, Father, I entrust this anger into your hands. If you're confused, Father, I entrust these things that are confusing me into your hands. If you're falling into despair, Father, I entrust these circumstances that are causing me to despair into your hands. And it just becomes a daily prayer, not just on the day you die, the daily prayer of constantly transferring over, saying, you know what? I don't have a very good safety deposit box, but God has a great one. And so whatever is worrying me, I'm putting that in the hands of somebody who's trustworthy, somebody who knows everything, always has my best interest in mind, and will always tell me the truth. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we invite your presence right now, Lord, as we close these next few moments. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling with something that's causing heaviness. If you have a dark cloud on you, it's dark. It should be noonday. It should be bright, but it's not. You're not sure how much of it's your own emotions, how much of it's outside of stuff. Lord, I break that in Jesus' name. Lord, you say in Scripture that it's the anointing that breaks the yoke, and that yoke can be a strangling type of thing around us. We're just weighted down with it. Maybe you feel like you have this harness weighted on you, depleting you, discouraging you. And so I want to pray for you, if that's you. In Jesus' name, Father, I just pray for power to be released. Lord, it's a spiritual thing. There's some things we don't see, but they're absolutely every bit as real. And so today, Lord, I pray, Father, for people to be released from that bondage. Those who are just, they've been dragging this heavy yoke around. this thing around their neck, this thing that's just causing them to not be able to enjoy life. Some of you have self-destructive things going on, and it's because of this thing that I'm talking about. God says, today I want you to be free. And so, Lord, I just pray that you ignite their faith. Lord, that you help them to lift up their eyes, change their gaze from looking down to looking up. God has a purpose for you. He's at work in that purpose. The enemy would try to come along and say, there's no purpose to this. God's forgotten you, but that is not true. That is a lie. God says his purpose is true for you. That you're here, and even our own mistakes, he will weave those into a pattern to still accomplish his purpose for you. The only thing that keeps you from following God's purpose for you is you. Today, would you say, Father, I entrust my life to you. If you've never done that or it's been a long time, it's time to rededicate. It's not about joining the church or something. It's about getting right with God. And so right now I'm going to ask you to pray right where you're at. In your mind, would you just say, Father, I entrust my life to you, into your hands. Today I want to start walking with you. I want to learn what it means to trust a Father who is trustworthy. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.